Information. Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Welcome to PolyU. The program will commence in 2 minutes. Please kindly be seated and be reminded to switch your mobile phone and electronic device to silent mode. Thank you for your cooperation.
Dear patrons, to avoid undue disturbance to the program and the audience, please switch off your mobile phones as well as the beeping devices on your watches before the program. Eating and drinking, as well as unauthorized photography, video, and audio recordings in the auditorium are forbidden. Thank you for your cooperation.
未免综艺馆的节目及观众受到骚扰，请各位关掉你的手提电话，并将手表响闹装置关上。请勿在场内饮食或擅自摄影、录影及录音。 敬请合作。
Professor Sun Dong, Professor Jing Guang Tang, Professor Christopher Chow, Professor Chi, Professor John Shi, honorable speakers, distinguished guests, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Welcome to the Global Smart Cities Summit, come the third International Conference on Urban Informatics, GSCS and ICUI 2023, jointly organized by the International Society for Urban Informatics and the Otto Poon Charitable Foundation Smart Cities Research Institute of the Hong Kong Polytechnic University. The opening ceremony today will be live streamed on multiple social media platforms. Let's also extend a warm welcome to our online audiences. And I am Helen, a final year student of PolyU and your MC today. Held biennially since 2017, the GSCS and ICUI is one of the largest and most prestigious events in the world for promoting innovations and inventions in the field of smart cities. Making a city smart, it's now emerging as a global strategy to embrace new technologies and insights to mitigate the many problems associated with urbanization, enhance city and organizational efficiency, and promote better living. At this three-day conference, we bring together stakeholders from various sectors, including academia, industry, government, R&D, enterprises, and many more, to present their inventions, research findings, and new products. In an era when many countries are pursuing smart city initiatives, international and professional exchange in this field is particularly important in navigating smart city development. Without further ado, may we invite Professor Jingguang Tang, President of PolyU, on stage for welcome remarks. Professor Tang, please.
Thank you. Okay, I have a speech to read, then halfway through I will show you some slides. So, Professor, the Honorable Sun Dong, distinguished speakers, respected industry leaders and government officials, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. On behalf of the Hong Kong Polytechnic University, it is my great pleasure to welcome you all to this Global Smart Cities Summit and the third International Conference on Urban Informatics, which is jointly organized by the International Society for Urban Informatics and the Otto, Poon, Charitable Foundation, Smart Cities Research Institute of PolyU. Since its inception in 2017, this biennial conference has been one of the most prestigious international events devoted to innovations and inventions in the field of smart cities. We are greatly honored today to have Professor Sun Dong, Secretary for Innovation, Technology and Industry, who will give our opening address in just a few moments. We also have a stellar lineup of keynote speakers from around the world to share the advances and challenges in urban planning and future city development. They include Professor Michael Betty from the University College London, Professor Michael Goodchild from the University of California Santa Barbara, Professor Gong Jianya from Wuhan University, Professor Guo Rengzhong from Shenzhen University, Professor Jing Ying from the University of Cambridge, Professor Anthony Yip from the University of Hong Kong, and Professor Carlo Ratti from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. In addition, Professor Zhou Chenghu from the Chinese Academy of Sciences will serve as our panel discussion co-chair in due time. So thank you all for your presence and support to us, and we look forward to hearing your insights. Now, obviously, smart cities is an important topic around the world, and especially for a big city like Hong Kong. And this is an area, therefore, the university, PolyU, has been devoting quite a lot of attention and effort. And in particular, in 2020, we set up this research institute, which is named the Otto, Poon Charitable Foundation Smart Cities Research Institute. And the reason why we have this name, Otto, Poon Charitable Foundation, was because we received a donation from our outstanding alumnus, Dr. Otto, Poon, of 100 million Hong Kong dollars in a few years ago. So we set up two research institutes which are named after him. So Dr. Poon actually is here with us today. Can we give Dr. Poon a round of applause to thank him? Can you stand up? Yeah. So So this is, you know, his donation has been very important for us to set up this research institute. Research institute, or they call it, you know, John one called a SCRI, has been quite active in developing technologies, because for all our research institutes, they are not only expected to engage in fundamental research, they also have to do research which is useful to the society. This is the position of PolyU. And so, for example, John has led his team in, during the pandemic time, developed a platform which is named the Spatial Temporal Big Data Platform for predicting the occurrence of cases, you know, COVID-19 cases in Hong Kong, and he constantly fed the information to the government, which helped the government in decision-making. And this invention garnered a number of awards, including the 2020 Smart 50 Award and a gold medal at the 48th Geneva Invention Expo. So I commend John's good work, and also I'm very impressed by the scale of the conference and all the work he has done, all the companies he has been able to attract to support the conference. Very good work. Let's give John also a round of applause for his good work. And I understand that today he is going to, release his Smart Cities Index. I hope your index will work well. Huh? So a few days ago, we have another organization called the PolyU Policy Research Center for Innovation and Technology. The leader of that is our VP Research, Professor Chris Chow. And they released another index called the Innovation Technology Index, I think. So Hong Kong ranked number 7 in the whole China, so we are still, well, not doing too badly, but we have. And he said, according to the blueprint released by our Secretary for Innovation, Technology, and Industry, Professor Sun Dong, if you realize your blueprint, it will become number 3, which is too good. So let's hope that will happen. Now, I would like now to show you a few slides. I have a PowerPoint file, which is quite standard, but I think I'm not going to show you all the slides because that will take too much time. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about the university. Now, this university started as a technical college in 1937. It was the second post-secondary education institution in Hong Kong after Hong Kong U. So Hong Kong U is the oldest and most prestigious university in Hong Kong. We have Professor Gong, who is their VP, who is here. So I'm not going to say anything bad about Hong Kong U today. But we actually have graduated almost 500,000 graduates, alumni, from this institution, which is, however, much bigger than the number produced by Hong Kong U. Of course, bigger is not better, but we have therefore made the biggest contribution to the manpower of Hong Kong in developing it itself into a big international urban center. Among our graduates, we have Dr. Otto Poon, whom I mentioned. We also have two so-called national-level leaders. The Chinese premier now is a graduate of our EMBA program, and the Mr. Liang, CY Liang, who was the former, who was the chief executive of Hong Kong, and now a national-level leader, was also a graduate from PolyU in the early 70s. So we can claim that we are the only university in Hong Kong which has produced two national leaders in Hong Kong. We have these are the faculties and the schools. If you look at this, I want to emphasize two things. One is that we have engineering faculty, which is for manufacturing. We have a construction faculty, which is for construction, which is also engineering, but construction related. In fact, over the last 30 years, construction has been more important as an engineering field than manufacturing in Hong Kong. Although, Professor Sun Dong will reverse this trend, I hope that will happen. In the near future, we are going to set up a new faculty for the digital era. So it will be a faculty consisting of computer science, applied mathematics, data science, and AI. And then our science faculty is fairly much engineering driven. The physics department is working on material science. We have a department of food science, which is often engineering in the mainland. Fashion textiles, we have a lot of technology people there who are supposed to be engineering, you know, textile engineering in the mainland. So this university is very heavy in engineering and technology. In addition, we have many unique disciplines. These are design, fashion design, hotel and tourism. We have things like optometry, physiotherapy, you know, in the health discipline. Even this discipline of geomatics we are concerned with today is quite unique in Hong Kong among the 8 public universities. So our strategy for the university, this is over-positioning. We just want to be very practical. You know, want to make direct contributions to the world through our research and innovation. But our strategy is to be, our positioning is to be an innovative world-class university. By that, we mean that our students should be leaders and drivers of innovation, and our research should produce innovations which are making direct positive impact on society. And we want to be innovative in everything we do at this university, including its management system and policies. In addition, we want to, more specifically, we want to be a national leader, you know, one of the best in China in the area of engineering and technology, because we are so strong, we have so many, you know, people in that area. And also in the unique disciplines, we want to be a world leader. We are already a world leader in many of these disciplines, things like hotel and tourism management, design, you know, physiotherapy, optometry, even in geomatics. I was told by John or Professor Chen Wu, they were among the leaders. If they are not, you can tell them that this is not true. Eh? Okay, so this is the way we position our university. So we have two-pronged approach. Okay, so at this moment, I want to show you the rankings of the university. People say, oh, why do you concern yourself with rankings? If we are already MIT, we are not going to talk about rankings, but we are not. So students actually look at rankings quite a lot. We watch out for our rankings as a reference for us. You know, we never do anything just for rankings. But you can see we are now in the top 100, so we can speak to people more with more confidence. In fact, Hong Kong is a good place because for universities, because we get the same level of funding as any other university for the same student we admit. There's no difference. So if Poly does not perform well after 30, 40 years from its conversion from a polytechnic to a university, then it's our own fault. And so we are confident they will continue to excel. Discipline ranking. So you can see that our university is ranked quite well in architecture and built environment, which is related to this field. Okay, so and civil engineering and design. So we are, according to QS rankings, we are quite strong. There are some other rankings, like the US News rankings, which rank us number 6 in the world in engineering, which I don't believe myself, so I never actually promote this ranking. So as a professor, we have to only promote things which we believe in ourselves, right? So, you know, that's a reality. Okay, I will jump through all this, and I want to tell you just one more thing, I'll then wrap up. Now, this is the research. This is where the research institute sits. So we have this PolyU Academy for Interdisciplinary Research. It's called a PAIR. You know, acronym is PAIR, which is easy to remember, which means collaboration. You have to pair up to do things. The reason we have this is because we want to address societal challenges through collaborative interdisciplinary research. At this university, we are not so much interested in the origin of the universe or the meaning of life. We leave that to Hong Kong U or Chinese U to study. You know, they have a philosophy department. We are more interested in the daily needs of the society. So in Chinese, we say 衣食住行, okay, 人间烟火. That's what we do. Okay, we want to make direct impact to the progress of society. So SCRI, which is the Smart Cities Research Institute, is in this list. Of course, we have another Otto, Poon Institute, which is for smart energy. Okay, so with that, I want to wrap up my speech by reading the last bit, which is It's quite easy to speak about this. So we want to finally thank everybody who have contributed to this conference, especially the team under Professor Jung Si, who have organized this great conference. And we also wish you a great time in Hong Kong, not only by talking to your peers, but also going out to see some of Hong Kong to see what has happened over the last 4 years under the pandemic. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you, Professor Tang. Please be seated. Next, may we invite the guest of honor, Professor Sun Dong, Secretary for Innovation, Technology and Industry, the Government of the Hong Kong SAR, to come on stage for an opening address. Professor Sun, please.
Professor Teng, Professor Shi, distinguished speakers and guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. It is my great pleasure to join you all today at the Global Smart Cities Summit, termed the third International Conference on Urban Informatics 2023. First of all, I would like to express my gratitude to the organizers who bring together experts, researchers, industry players, policymakers, and investors around the world who are strong advocates of smart cities to this biennial event in Hong Kong. Hong Kong is an epitome of urbanized cities. Strong population growth in cities in the past century has necessitated more sustainable urban planning, improved transportation scales, affordable housing, and better management of energy and resources. As compared with our predecessors a few decades ago, we are lucky that with the advent of advanced technology and innovation, we can rise to such challenges with relative ease. For instance, we can now deploy the digital twin technology to simulate different scenarios for performance monitoring, informed decision making, facility management, risk reduction, efficiency improvement, and many other usages. We can use artificial intelligence to work out the optimized traffic route to save traveling time. These are just a few examples of how our standard of living has been improved under the smart city development. Hong Kong first published our smart city blueprint in 2017 and updated it in 2020, involving over 130 measures on different fronts. This lays the foundation for Hong Kong to develop into a smart city in a progressive manner. Last December, the government published the Hong Kong Innovation and Technology Development Blueprint to establish a clear development path and formulate systematic strategic planning for our INT development over the coming 5 to 10 years. Charting Hong Kong in moving full steam towards the vision of an international INT center. Under this blueprint, we spare no effort in promoting digital economy development and building Hong Kong into a smart city through a data-driven approach. Data plays a key role in the digital era. Without data, smart city development and urban informatics will be just empty talks. Hong Kong has been proactive in opening up government data free of charge since 2018. At present, more than 5,200 data sites and over 2,200 application programming interfaces are available in the public sector information portal. In December 2022, we launched the Common Spatial Data Infrastructure Portal and the first 3D visualization map data size for the public's free consumption. Over 500 spatial data sites from various government departments are made available through this portal, covering different aspects such as planning, lands, building, works, population, and transportation, etc. Government alone cannot make magic happen. Thus, we strive to collaborate and create synergy with our key partners and stakeholders in the promotion of smart city development. In Greater Bay Area, for example, Hong Kong signed a cooperation agreement with Guangdong to co-develop into a smart city cluster. In Anjun, we entered into a memorandum of understanding with the mainland to facilitate cross-boundary data flow within the Greater Bay Area in a safe and orderly manner. This, I would say, is a major milestone in Hong Kong's development into a smart city and contribution to the GBA smart city cluster. As an offshore location of our country, Hong Kong enjoys the advantages of one country, two systems. Coupled with our competitive edge in financial services, legal system, innovation and technology, digital infrastructure, and traditional services, Hong Kong has a unique advantage to develop into an important hub where data from mainland and overseas enterprises can be integrated to take forward the development of smart city and digital economy. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure you all look forward to and will benefit from the enlightening sharing by the many distinguished speakers in the week to come. I wish you all a rewarding conference and the best of health. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sun. Thank you, Professor Sun. Please have a seat. Thank you. Countries around the world are now pursuing smart city developments and policies, infrastructure, healthcare, transportation, and many more areas. And smart city index and rankings have emerged as a new critical tool to assess the various aspects of smart cities and guide nations' smart city development. Several indexes have been developed by research institutes. This year's conference program includes a pre-conference training held yesterday, as well as a three-day conference which comprises keynote addresses, paper presentations, a technology innovation exhibition, and laboratory visits. Now, how do these various genres of activities foster insights, in-depth exchanges, and collaboration? And what are some of the important themes? On this occasion, we would love to give you more information about the event and take this opportunity to announce Smart City Index and Ranking. Now, may we invite Professor John Shi Wenzhong, President of the International Society for Urban Informatics and Director for Otto Poon Charitable Foundation Smart Cities Research Institute, to come on stage for the conference introduction and Smart City and Ranking announcement. Professor Shi, please.
Good morning, everyone. Professor Shen, President Tan, and dear guests. It's our pleasure to welcome here to attending this conference, Global Smart City Summit, and a third international conference on urban informatics. Today, I will share two things. One is Smart City Index, and another is the conference. May I have the Smart City Index PowerPoint first, if possible? Okay. Yes. Okay. We have a team over 10 people and work for 3 years. Then we work on the Smart City Index. Now it's called International Society Urban Informatics Smart City Index. I will report from these four areas: aim and a feature of our index. We aim to develop a universally applicable, objective, comprehensive, and human-centric smart city index, fully based on public available data. So we have two, there's four important features: universal, so it's balanced the consideration of stage of development and culture of different cities, and objective and repeatable, and fully based on public available, and human-centric, then concentrating on the impact and change of that smart city brings to the life of a citizen. And also comprehensive, 98 indicators were used for the six wheels of a smart city. Now, indicator framework. So we have formed indicators by six wheels in the six wheels. 22 indicators on the smart mobility, 17 on environment, 17 on the economy, and 13 on living, and 14 on people, and finally 15 on government or governance. So that's our indicator design: independent, comprehensive, universal, representative, quantifiable, available, objective, interpretable, and keep updating. So that's our system of the indicators, include objective, category, indicator. So for example, for the smart mobility, we have objective mobility infrastructure, intelligent mobility, public mobility, private, shared, and safe, affordable mobility. So for each of those, then we have categories in the middle, and also the indicators at the last, which are the quantified, and then we'll do the computation. Smart living, again, through communication, housing, healthcare, safety, security, social charity, and equity, and culture. Environment, environmental facilities, structures, and management. And people, resistance, ability of development, physical, mental, health, and development environment. And government, on the integration, transparency, and collaboration. And economy, current economic status, economic environment, and electronic economic future, like e-commerce. Indicator framework. So we select 50 representative cities around the world. That's the spatial distribution of the cities. So that's the ranking. Perhaps you are interested about that. We take that 50 cities, representative cities, then necessary. The ranking result, then Copenhagen, Stockholm, Helsinki, Berlin, New York, Toronto, Zurich, Oslo, Hong Kong, London, Seoul, Munich, Barcelona, Singapore, and Paris, and so on and so forth. We have funding. So for megacity, naturally, it's difficult to be ranking high when we consider per capita quality of life. And that figure, we find the pattern, the cluster of distribution. So the right part, this part, then this is for megacities, and this slide for 15 million population. So then we cluster the ranking should be for megacities or larger cities. So from here, 15 million. So then, based on that, then we classify on those super-sized cities. Then based on that, then we have Tokyo, Beijing, Shenzhen, Shanghai, and other cities. So analysis. So the top three cities overall ranking, they're North European cities, and they have a relatively small population size, And the index emphasizes residents' quality of life, which is closely related to the per capita resources available. And for supersized cities, Tokyo, Beijing, and Shenzhen, they perform very well, and they all are located in East Asia and a high ranking in smart economy. Then the dimensions, smart mobility. Over 50% of select city have made substantial progress in new mobility technology, smart living, and European cities perform better than other regions. Smart economy, environment, the developing economics trying to have high ranks. Smart people, then overall, European and American cities have higher per capita level of education. Smart government, 80 to 60% of cities have been developed e-government platform and open data. And smart economy, Asia developed cities and newly developed the industrialized cities performs very well. So just before I complete, here, because we're here in Hong Kong, let me see a few more words about Hong Kong. Then based on our the data analysis, Hong Kong performance well this time. And I think the smart city blueprint, which guides the overall smart city development in the city, promotes very important foundation. And common spatial data infrastructure, three-dimensional city infrastructure developed by Development Bureau and Lands Department forms the foundation's infrastructure to the city. And open data policy of the government supporting very well. So this is a brief summary on the analysis of the smart city. Then for more details, if you are interested in our work on smart city index, the white paper is there. And you can always go there for the details and for our analysis for many cities you're interested in. So with that, then I conclude the first part of presentation on Smart City Index. Let me continue in the second part, introduction to conference. That's more relaxed. So this is the third urban informatics conference, on international conference, urban informatics. And we also add a Global Smart City Summit. This is very important because I think smart city development is one of the trends of the world. Then we also formed based on the foundation science and technology for urban informatics and see what's happened to the smart city development in the real world. So let me briefly introduce that four areas. First of all, urban informatics is an emerging transdiscipline. Just like our President Tan mentioned, I think the future interdiscipline or transdiscipline is the one of the trends for the science and technology development. Here, for urban informatics, we define the urban science, computer science, geoinformation, and probably relate many others, which forms the basis for this transdiscipline urban informatics. And many scientists, they are sitting here today. We form as the scientific and technology foundations for smart city, include the urban science, urban big data infrastructure, urban computing, urban systems and applications, and urban science, which are the systems we formed for that scientific and technology foundation. Development in urban informatics. Here, many of us working together here, we form International Society for Urban Informatics with following five commissions emphasize that these are the areas we emphasize for science and technology development and solutions for smart city. And we form this book. That's the first book comprehensively introduced the smart city series and series technology and applications. And with 1.4 million chapter downloads so far with the 2 years and to be highly comment, even being used the text or reference book by many universities like MIT, Zhenjiang University, and many others I heard about. Here we have other three guest editors here, Professor Guchai, Professor Betty, Anshu, and so we work together for the last 2 years. We should give a proud applause to them. Actually, I should say we worked this book and the most time remotely during COVID compact, but we successfully managed to have that book published. It's not easy, but we managed to publish high book and form the foundation for science and development for urban informatics. And then index, smart city index, that's with the foundation of science or technology or smart city, and then we further develop, go to the smart city index, and that's to help the cities to diagnose the strengths and weakness of smart city development and the strengths and have a better smart city development for each of the cities. And Urban Informatics Journal, then we work together and for this new journal, because we believe for urban informatics, we need a long-term development, and we need a joint efforts from the scientists working in that area. And the journal is the best platform, one of the best platform to put paper together and put the findings and the science and technology development together. And after 10 years or 20 years, then we form the foundation for that science and technology, urban informatics. Urban informatics education, more and more universities worldwide start and have started work on the education programs on urban informatics related programs. MIT with a bachelor in urban informatics and planning with computer science, which is an interdiscipline between computer science and urban science. UCL, the Hong Kong Polytechnic University, and many others you see here. So that means in long term, we can educate, nurture the new generations with the strong academic background in urban informatics, which will contribute to the future development of a smart city. Urban Informatics Conference is another very important program we're working on, and for the long-term development of smart city, we provide this platform opportunity for science professionals, government people to work together and to discuss and to motivate each other and for long-term development of urban informatics and a smart city. So we started from 2017, and then second one is 19. The third one should be 2021, but due to COVID, then we stopped. But we successfully organized webinar in between. Actually, we received 200,000 views for this program, so which is very good. Now today is third International Conference on Urban Informatics. The future of smart cities, then dual AI. I think you will see AI is a trend. In our field, we add a dual AI. So which is the AI applied for spatial related information and images and maps and data. So that's to say, for example, based on satellite image, we detect the landslide and which is represented in red. So we can, from image, use the new technology CAM and SIM. So GeoFame, GeoK, AGI, and others, or explainable AI, that's the future trend of AI. And some of that relates to our, it's called GeoAI. Another example is GeoAI applications based on mobile mapping system and take a LiDAR data and an image of the road and use the SAM adapter, that's new AI technology, to quickly detect defects of the road. Digital twin, I think you will believe with me. I watch my watch, okay. And mobile mapping system for general digital twin and integrate the digital twin with the AI, IoT, and digital simulation for domain solutions and the digital solutions for digital economy in the future. That's an example of a digital twin based on mobile mapping system and to produce that digital twin of one of the buildings in Hong Kong. You will see this is a very clear and a digital twin even be used for, say, for example, metaverse in the future. Autonomous driving, high definition map is the map for autonomous driving in the future. Then we needed to have a mobile mapping system for high definition mapping, centimeter level accuracy, AI-based method for road object automatically, and standards for high definition map, real-time data capture and updating. These are very important research issues for the future high definition map for autonomous driving. Say, for example, this is one of the autonomous driving purpose of a high definition map simulation. And we need to have a vehicle-based mobile mapping system for generate the mobile mapping high definition map. From left is the devices for mobile mapping system, and generate laser point cloud, and finally the high definition map on the right. Resilient city and global health, that's one issue we're facing. In the past years, we faced the difficulties of COVID. Then we needed to develop the e-solution for combat the COVID already passed, but something in future may come. Smart living for everyone, and the gleam of cities, that's a conference. We have 7 keynotes, and technology innovation, smart city index, 230 presentations, featured sessions, and award. You will see it's a rich program for this conference. Smart city, a better life for everyone. That's our vision. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Xi, and please remain on stage for the official opening of the conference. We are honored to gather academia and industry leaders at this conference to foster collaboration and exchanges of ideas in the coming 3 days. For the official commencement of the conference, let's put our hands together and invite officiating guests to join Professor Xi on stage for the grand opening. And they are Professor Sun Dong, Secretary for Innovation, Technology and Industry, the Government of the Hong Kong SAR. Professor Jing Guang Tang, President of PolyU. Mr. Tony Wong, Government Chief Information Officer. Professor Michael Goodchild, member of the U.S. National Academy of Sciences. Professor Christopher Chow, Vice President, Research and Innovation of PolyU. Professor Michael Batty, Fellow of the Royal Society. Dr. Otto Poon, founder of the Otto Poon Charitable Foundation. Professor Gong Peng, Vice President and Pro Vice Chancellor, Academic Development of the University of Hong Kong. And Professor Chan Ching Yan, Director of PolyU Academy for Interdisciplinary Research. Excellent. It seems that our officiating guests on stage are almost ready. Okay, and for all guests on stage, as we count down from five, you can see there's a hand on the LED wall. Please place your hand on the LED wall as we count down for the official opening. Yes. Yeah, you can place your left hand, maybe. Yes. All right. Let's turn a little bit towards the floor. You can do it this way. Yeah, great, okay. Yeah, great, okay, we're looking good. Let's hold, okay, looking good. Okay, are you ready? And everybody, let's count down together. 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1. The Global Smart City Summit from the 3rd International Conference on Urban Informatics has officially started. Thank you all, and let's all take a step forward to the center of the stage for a group photo. Okay. Let's step towards the center a little bit. Yes. Okay, and when you're ready, smile. Let's hold your smile for a little while. Snap a couple more pictures. Okay, thank you all, and please do remain on stage. We would like to take another photo. The conferences would not be possible without the concerted efforts of our speakers, organizers, supporting organizations, and key partners. We would like to take this opportunity to capture this significant moment together. And first, let's invite the following speakers on stage. They include Professor Anthony Ye, Academician of the Chinese Academy of Sciences, Chair Professor of the University of Hong Kong. Professor Guo Renzhong, Academician of the Chinese Academy of Engineering, Dean of the Shenzhen University. Professor Gong Jianya, Academician of the Chinese Academy of Sciences, Professor of Wuhan University. Professor Zhou Chenghu, Academician of the Chinese Academy of Sciences. And Professor Jin Ying, Director of the Martin Center for Architectural and Urban Studies, University of Cambridge. Okay, all guests ready, please. 1, 2, 3, smile. Okay, thank you. Thank you all. And for Professor Tang, Professor Chow, Professor Chen, Professor Xi, Professor Ye, Professor Guo, please stay. And other speakers and guests, please have a seat. And once again, thank you for sharing your insights and expertise on this occasion with us. Professor Sun, Professor Tang, Professor Chow, Professor Xi, please stay. Professor Chen as well from PEAR. We would like to take a couple more pictures for this at this very special occasion. And up next, we would like to invite representatives from our exhibitors of the conference on stage for a group photo to capture this memorable moment. Exhibitors, please. And for this year, we have gathered a total of 28 exhibitors from Hong Kong, mainland, and overseas. And our exhibitors comprises an array of industry and academia professionals from different sectors, including geosystem, urban informatics, surveying, engineering, space technology, and architectural and urban studies. And through the conference, our exhibitors will be showcasing their work at Technology Innovation Exhibition, which may cover topics and inventions that speaks to your interest. As we welcome our representatives of our exhibitors on stage, and they will also be there in the exhibitions. So in case you don't see them on stage now, they will be around the conference. So do grab the opportunity to chat with them and know a little bit more about their research and findings. Okay, thank you for the patience because we have 28 of them. So it does take a little bit more time. So let's check if the pictures are okay. Second row, please all move towards a little bit to your right side. Guest on the second row, please move towards a little bit to your right side. Yes, thank you. Thank you all. And yes, And when you're ready, smile. Okay, thank you all. And please, exhibitors, representatives, please have a seat. Thank you. And Professor Sun, Professor Tang, Professor Chow, Professor Chen, Professor Xi, we have one more photo to take with our supporting organizations. One more photo with our supporting organizations, yes. And then we are excited to delve deeper into the research findings and inventions at the exhibition that takes place in parallel of the conference sessions. And up next, may I invite representatives from supporting organizations on stage for a group photo. They are Professor Huang Zhandong from the Shenzhen University. Professor Huang, please. Ms. Jennifer Chan from Infest Hong Kong. Ms. Winnie Xu and from the International Federation of Surveyors. Dr. Liu Xintao from the International Cartographic Association. Professor Zhang Qingming, Chinese Society for Geodesy, Photogrammetry and Cartography. Engineer Dr. Barry Li from the Hong Kong Institute of Engineers. Mr. Gary Young from the Smart City Consortium. Ms. Zoe Lam from Construction Industry Council. Surveyor Raymond Kam from the Hong Kong Institute of Surveyors. And Surveyor Edmund Lam from the Hong Kong Science and Technology Park. Thank you for supporting our conference. And when you're ready, one, two, three, smile. Oh, let's move a little bit towards the center. Yes, and smile. Okay. Thank you all guests on stage. And thank you all for supporting the conference once again. May all guests on stage please have a seat. And the field of urban informatics harnesses the power of data and information as well as communication technology in studying dynamics between people and their living environment. The discipline is an important building block for smart city development. And as part of the conference, we have set up two prizes to honor individuals who have made significant contributions to smart city development with their excellence in urban informatics. And on this special occasion, we would like to present the awards to the winners. And let's invite Professor Xi on stage and our and Professor Sun and Professor Tang as well for presenting the awards. And now may I pass the time to Professor Xi to announce and introduce our winners.
Thank you. Award presentation for appreciate the outstanding achievement of international leading science in urban informatics. Now we have outstanding achievement on urban informatics. Here are our awardees. They are Peter Atkinson from University Lancaster, Professor Jiang Gong from Wuhan University, Professor Ren Zhongguo from Shenzhen University, Professor Harvey Miller from Ohio State University, Professor Calorati from MIT, Professor Martin Robol from ETH Zurich, Professor Anthony Ye from Hong Kong University, and Professor Zhou from Chinese Academy of Science. Congratulations. Now, we invite the four awardees today present in this conference. That's Professor Gong, please. And Professor Guo from Shenzhen University, please. And then Professor Ye from Hong Kong U. And Professor Zhou from Chinese Academy of Science. Now we invite our distinguished guest, Professor Shen Dong, and to deliver the two awards, Professor Gong.
Yes.
This is Professor Guo, from Shenzhen University. Now we invite President Tan to award the third one, Professor Anthony Ye. Professor Zhou, yes. Yeah, we may take picture together here. Okay, for rest of the awardees, Professor Calarotti, he will arrive this afternoon, then we will present in this evening's dinner ceremony. And for the rest of Peter and Javi and also the Martin, then we will present them, we will send our award on behalf of this International Society on Urban Informatics. The next part will be Best Paper Award. We have 10 Best Paper Award for the conference and another 10 for Merit. We receive many very high-quality papers. That's the selection result. Due to time limitation for this morning, we will present also this part, Best Paper Award, to during the dinner time. And we also present other award certificate also during the dinner time. With that, I conclude the award ceremony part.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Xi. Please have a seat. And congratulations once again to all winners and all nominees and winners of the Best Paper Award. Congratulations. And before we proceed, let us first take a 30-minute coffee break. Light refreshments have been prepared outside the auditorium at the foyer level, and the program and live streaming will resume at 10:50 a.m. See you all in a bit and enjoy the break. Thank you.
Thank you. ladies and gentlemen, the next session will begin. This session will be chaired by me and Professor Guo Lianzhong. First, I will chair for the Professor Michael Beatty. First, I introduce some information about the Michael Beatty. Michael Beatty is the Bartlett Professor of Planning at UCL. He is the chair of the Center of Advanced Spatial Analysis, and also is a Turing Fellow in Early Turing Institution. His award on the computer models of cities and the visualization since 1970s. He's a fellow of the British Academy and the Royal Society. Welcome, Professor Michael Beatty. At first, I will give you the notification.
Oh, thank you very much. Yes, very well. How about that? Okay.
Thank you for the introduction, Professor Gong. Please have a seat. And I will now pass the stage to Professor Beatty. Professor Beatty, the time is yours.
Okay, thanks very much. Thank you for inviting me. One of the things that I think we try and teach our students is that your PowerPoint slides should be large enough for people to read. In fact, this is the first time that the slides have been too big, almost, in a sense. And I don't know what that looks like. It doesn't look too bad, basically, in a sense, but it's the biggest scale I've ever projected at. Okay, so let me tell you what we're going to do. We're both, in fact, going to talk about digital twins. Now, digital twins is the flavor of the month, as we should say. Everything seems to be a digital twin. To cut a very long story short, we'll both elaborate the long story, myself and my good child, in a moment. Basically, a digital twin is essentially a model of a system. And of course, as you know, we can build lots of different types of models of lots of different systems. So to some extent, it's not really necessary to define a digital twin if we accept the idea that it's a model. So let me tell you what I'm actually going to do in terms of material. If you want to actually see the presentation, the tiny URL, which is the second web address on that particular page. The tiny URL, I think, should actually pull up the PDF, basically, of what you're going to see. I will, in fact, not go through all the PowerPoint slides, basically, in the interest of time in that sense. But nevertheless, if you want to get this, you can actually take a photo of that and pull it down. Now, I think it will work. One of the features was that we had to send the presentation slides, we had to send the PowerPoint slides last week to Stella, as one of the organizers of the meeting, basically, so I'm not absolutely sure whether the link, in fact, would give you precisely the one, but I think it probably will. Okay, so let me tell you what I'm going to talk about. Models, twins, and abstractions. I've already made the point that we can think of a digital twin as a model, and we can also think as an abstraction. All models, I was certainly taught, you know, as a student, are simplifications of the real thing. As Einstein said, all good theory is simple, but not too not necessarily too simple. Basically, in that sense, twins as models, twins as controllers, and the humans in the loop. The other point I'd like to make is that when we talk about models and talk about digital twins, then we often forget that we are in the loop. We're the people selecting the model, selecting the real system, and in that context. And so consequently, humans in the loop is a very important thing. I'll say a little bit about where the digital twins come from, what are their features, and then I'll digress slightly because an excellent example of a digital twin is a map. We can scale a map at different scales, which represent different levels of representation at these scales, basically. And in that sense, they're the changing kinds of abstractions maps, in a sense, some really quite nice sort of general kind of statements made about maps as digital twins in that sense. I'll also then begin to look at different digital twins. I'm going to preface this with the idea of the non-digital twin, because in a sense, although we're going to be talking about models which are essentially digital, computer models in that sense, we still use a very wide variety of non-digital twins. If you go, certainly as I've been into mainland China, you can see the city exhibitions. City exhibitions are largely digital in the big cities, but they're also non-digital, basically, in the traditional sense. So I'm going to make that contrast, because ultimately, I think we're going to be talking about everything being a digital twin in a digital world in the next 20, 30 years or so, when more and more things are digital. The non-digital is going to become a bit rarer. In fact, you probably won't see many architects working with traditional models, basically analog models in that sense, which are non-digital. You'll see them working with digital. Or that's a speculation. Maybe that'll happen, maybe not, I don't know. Okay, so the types of digital twins. I'm going to show you some examples of four digital twins, or four models, I should say, which are all built of the same area. In our group at CASA, we've got people working on 3D city models, basically, which are perhaps the example par excellence of a digital twin. We've also got one or two people working on smart buildings, BIMs, etc. We've got people working on models of transport in real time, basically, on the subway systems and so on. Last but not least, we have our long-term low-frequency models of urban change, which are traditional land-use transportation models. And I'm going to spend a little bit more time talking about that because we're beginning to tweak that model and develop different versions of it, which indeed are twins of twins in that sense. Okay, so we'll look at some explicit twins on this model, which we call quant. And then I'll round it off before I hand over to Mike and say a few things about what's next. Now, we've not coordinated between the two talks in any sense, and I hope that they'll be quite complementary, but we may say the same sorts of things at the various points to reinforce the point. Okay, now computing, and this is a very obvious point, it's changed the nature of how we theorize and model the physical as well as the social world. And we now have the possibility, really for the first time, I think, if you think back that we're talking about 75 years since the first digital computers were developed. After 75 years, we've just about got to the point where we can build more than one model of the same thing. Prior to this point, if we were building a model of a city, for example, it's likely we'd be building one model. And that's largely due to the fact that the resources, the human resources, were limited, and at the same time, the data was limited and our perspectives were limited in that sense. And computer power was limited, up to the point now where we can build many models of the same thing. So one of the kind of key themes in this talk is that we've now entered the era of many models of the same thing. And on the back of all this sort of thinking about the fact that we can build more than one model of Hong Kong, in that sense, and they may be very similar, or they may be very different in this sense, on the back of that has come this idea of the digital twin. It's been driven very hard in the last 5 years, largely due to increases in computational power. The other kind of key feature in all of this is that the term digital twin is riddled with ambiguity. It's highly evocative of our wishing to get as close as possible to the real thing, but never actually getting to the real thing. The whole point about a model is it's a simplification. We throw more away than what we keep in most models in this particular context. And in that sense, the digital twin is a sort of a paradox. It can never be a true twin. And there's lots of elaborations of our language in this sense. We talk about identical digital twins, basically, or perhaps digital triplets, digital quadruplets, and so on and so forth in that context. So there are all sorts of paradoxes in the semantics which are involved in that. Now, somebody asked me about half an hour ago to give a definition of a digital twin. So I said, well, come to the lecture and I'll give it. So here's the definition of a digital twin I took from a book which was produced, or a paper, I should say, produced by the Centre for Digital Built Britain over in Cambridge, UK. And it says, a digital twin, also referred to as a digital shadow, digital replica, digital mirror, is a digital representation of physical assets. That's important in some definitions of digital twin. Linked to each other, the physical and digital twin regularly exchange data throughout the life cycle and use phase. Technology like AI, machine learning, sensors, IoT, allow for the dynamic data gathering and the right time data exchange to take place. Now, that's a very specific definition of a digital twin. When it comes to an entire city, which we might abstract in terms of land use patterns and so on in this context, then this particular definition isn't quite right in a sense. It has to be changed in that sense. So really the point is that it's not possible to define a digital twin. The best way of defining it is to think of it as a model, basically, which of course we've been doing for many years. Okay, so this implies that in the future there'll be multiple models of the same thing, and this will really become the norm, basically, so multiple twins in this. Now, the many models of the same system schools have been around for quite a few years. Counter-modeling was proposed by Greenberger, Krenzner, and Critty in a book called Models in the Policy Process, Russell Sage Foundation, in 1976. And they had lots of examples of where the Federal Reserve, for example, in Washington, D.C., when they were making predictions, they would have a basket of models. This was back in the 70s. They would have, 10 or 20 econometric models developed by different economic advisory groups around the U.S., basically, and they would pool the results, basically. Many models which would fight against each other, counter each other. Of course, the Bank of England do this, and your bank here, whatever the agency is, would be doing the same. This happens all over the world now. Many models are the same thing. Of course, in weather forecasting, this has been a really time-honored thing. The notion that we produce different forecasts and we actually pool them in some sense. Sometimes it's referred to as an ensemble of predictions in that sense. Lots of people, George Box, Scott Page has written a book called The Model Thinker, Dirk Helbing from ETH and so on. They've all written about the idea of many models. And George Box, who is a statistician, he articulated it rather well when he said in the 1970s, all models are wrong, but some are useful. Now, that's a very important mantra. If you're into writing it on your arm, basically, or these days, I suppose you'd tattoo it on your arm, wouldn't you, basically? All models are wrong, but some are useful. It's the kind of mantra, really, to some extent, of modeling. And, of course, the big question is, if we have more than one model of the same thing and all are plausible, how do we use them? How do we integrate them? How close are they to the real thing? Okay, so twins linking models, twins as a controller. So I've said all of this, really. Models are abstractions, in a sense, in this particular context. And one of the kind of key things is that models can simulate themselves. In fact, computers can simulate themselves. Back in the days when the philosophy of computation was being developed by John von Neumann and Alan Turing and so on in that sense, one of the kind of key things, and we tend to forget this, we have to be reminded all the time, that a computer is basically the only thing that we know that can simulate itself. The whole point about the Turing machine was that the computer could simulate itself in this particular context. And these are referred to as universal machines. Back in the 1940s, when Turing and von Neumann said all of this, the notion that you could actually build a computer model of a city or of a building, basically, was just off the scale. I mean, nobody ever imagined it. But, of course, if you look at the notion that the computer is a universal machine, it can do anything that can be reduced to zeros and ones, basically, in that particular context. And as we've found out in the last 75 years, we can do that in lots of different ways, basically. Now, an excellent example, I think, of a digital twin contains all this sort of ambiguity, was produced by Gordon Pask in his little book in the 1950s called Introduction to Cybernetics. And this is the picture, basically. This is Pask's cartoon back in 61 in his approach to cybernetics. Pask, in fact, was involved in both computing and in architecture, basically, architecture and planning and so on back then, in a sense. And you can see that this is this contains all the things. One of the kind of key things that the human is in the loop, basically. We have a black box, basically, which is mirroring really what goes on. And inside of the black box is some sort of traffic system. It's being monitored with wires and sensors, but it's also being monitored by the individuals, the stakeholders, the humans in the loop, basically, by looking through the window and seeing it for real. So it's got a mixture of digital and analog data in this particular context. And in some sense, it contains all the elements that really relate to a model in this particular context. Okay, and of course, how close is this to the real thing? And you can see immediately there's lots of ambiguity about the closeness in this sense. So here's a kind of schematic of it, the real system, and then the digital twin, basically, in that sense. One of the kind of criteria is that the digital twin must depend, in some sense, for information exchange between the real system. So there is a loop, basically, that the real system spews out data, which is taken by the digital twin to either control the system or indeed to understand the system, and it's then fed back that understanding or control into the real system. So you can think of this as being a classic positive, negative or positive feedback loop in that sense. Into this picture is the human loop, the human in the loop, I should say, and then you can build various digital twins. If you build more than one in that sense, it poses the question, how do we integrate them? There are multiple ways in this sense. Okay, so back in the 1940s, when the first digital computers were actually put together, and this is a picture of the ENIAC, which came out of the Moore School of Engineering in the University of Pennsylvania in 1945, and it was then picked up by John von Neumann and taken to the Institute of Advanced Study at Princeton, where he worked on the project. And this is a quote from Harry Reid, who joined the von Neumann project in 1950. And he said, "Now we can think of a personal computer as one that you can carry around with you," in that sense, reflecting on this time. But he says the ENIAC was actually a computer that you could actually live inside. So here is a picture of a person who is not only solving a computable problem, like tic-tac-toe or something, or chess, but also basically fixing the machine and developing the machine at the same time. So in other words, getting inside the machine is not so different from if we thought of the machine as being the city. Are we moving back to the same thing full circle? Are we living inside a computer in some sense? So this is the long-term speculation about all of this. Okay, so where do digital twins come from? Michael Greaves in 2003, I think, who was a production engineer in Michigan, he basically wrote about it, but the paper didn't really come out until 2014. Looked at it in terms of physical digital twins in this particular context. And there are a number of properties that are significant. I'll just go through these quickly. It can't be a mirror image. It's a replica. It cannot be the same as the original, or can it? And I'm prefacing these with question marks because we don't really know. Digital twins depend on their media. And if the media is close to the media of the original model, if it's digital, a digital model of a digital system, in a sense, is probably as close as we can get for a twin in this sense. Can a digital twin predict the future? We don't know. The future doesn't exist yet in that sense. A digital twin is always a coupling between the system and the model, basically. It's transfer of information, and it's also a controller. So many of the things that we've learned about in cybernetics and systems theory and in complexity theory over the last few years are really bound up in this notion about thinking about validation. Okay, now, I don't know whether Mike's going to say this, but what we probably need is a kind of a Turing test for digital twins. We need to, if we've got two models, we should have a test of some sort that says, you know, are these models identical, or are they twins? Or are they twins in the sense that they're not quite identical, but almost identical? Coining a test, if you like, for validating whether two models are the same is a kind of important characteristic. In fact, the Turing test, which was originally to test whether or not a machine was a human or a computer in this sense, rather than one digital twin or the other, the Turing test, in a sense, can never be passed, basically, in a sense, because we are always in the loop. We're always, to some extent, potentially controllers in that sense. Okay, now, very quickly, maps as analogies. The most evocative metaphors about digital twins really relate to maps. And maps are all about scale, as Benoit Mandelbrot, the inventor of fractals, taught us in the 1960s and so on, in that sense. Now, the best digital twin story I've ever heard is the one from Lewis Carroll, who was the author of Alice in Wonderland and so on, who in his last work, Sylvie and Bruni Concluded, tells of a conversation between himself and a German gentleman about making a map close to the real thing. Unfortunately, in my youth, I could actually perfect a very good German accent, basically. I can't do it anymore. Of course, people from Liverpool always said they could speak German particularly well. We're good students in that sense. But I've been out of Liverpool for so long, you know, that I've lost my ability to speak Liverpoolian with a German accent. But let me read out the conversation that goes in the Lewis Carroll book. It's between me and mine Herr. And I begin by saying, what a useful thing a pocket map is, I remarked. Mein Herr, that's another thing we've learned from your nation, said Mein Herr. Map making, but we've carried it much further than you. What do you consider the largest map that'd be really useful? Me, about 6 inches to a mile. Mein Herr, only 6 inches, exclaimed Mein Herr. We very soon got to 6 yards to the mile. Then we tried 100 yards to the mile, and then came the grandest idea of all. We actually made a map of the country on the scale of a mile to a mile. Me, have you used it much, I inquired. It has never been spread out yet, said Mein Herr. The farmers objected. They said it would cover the whole country and shut out the sunlight. So now we use the country itself as its own map, and I assure you it does nearly as well. Now, of course, this little phrase, basically, is quite a denunciation of the idea of a model, basically, that you don't really need a model, that the real thing is out there and you can sort of experiment and understand it directly. Okay. Now, there's lots of examples of this. These are some of the people who have written about it, basically. I'm not going to talk about this, but if you look at the English patient, you can think of the history that Ralph Fiennes there in the English Patient movie. He's reading Herodotus the Histories, basically, in the Western Desert and so on. The Borges thing on exactitude in science is all about a one-to-one map in the Western Desert, basically. So it's very evocative in some sense, both the movie and those stories about it. Okay, now, last but not least, and I'm sure I'm running out of time, but I'll speed up in a moment. I'd like to just take this from 1974 Urban Development Models Conference at Churchill College, Cambridge, when my friend Lionel March, basically, gave a talk where he introduced the same thing, and I've just picked this out. He says in this talk, all models to be useful must be selective. And if you like, false to reality in some respect or other, pocket models may be the most useful thing in the end. Okay, now very quickly, my 4 different types of digital twin, 3D cities, smart building, flows of traffic, and Luti models, all of these models are being built in our group by really rather different people. The people doing the BIMs and the 3D cities type stuff, Andy Hudson-Smith and his colleagues, have a very different mindset from people like myself who are working with the mathematical models and so on, and they have a very different mindset from people working on agent-based models of traffic and other people who are working on data science approaches and so on. So, in other words, we're bringing different models to bear on the same place, but they're very different models. They're twins in the sense that they pertain to the same place, and they may be useful for looking at a particular location from different perspectives. And to some extent, we're talking about models of the same thing, but from different perspectives, different theories in that sense. Okay, now we've written a little bit about digital twins, basically, but we're very proud of this paper that only took 2 years to come out. It's written by a variety of authors, including myself, and it's in, everybody has to produce something in a Nature journal these days, Nature Computational Science, the role of complexity for digital twins of cities in that sense. So let me actually go back to before digital twins, and this is my own non-digital twin. I'm very proud of this, that this is my own model in my second year or third year of university in the architecture school at Manchester in 1964, I think. And this was one of our models that we had to get. I have a nice photograph taken by my brownie sort of black and white little box, basically, Kodak box, basically, at that point, and printed out. The model is long gone. I think it was in my mother's attic, and she threw the model out, basically. But we do have the photograph, in a sense. So non-digital twins. And there are plenty of them out there, basically. This is a picture taken about 3 weeks ago in the Bartlett School of Architecture, basically. And this is the summer exhibition. If you go here to the Zaha Hadid building, you can see that they've too got their summer exhibition on, basically. So the whole of 22 Gordon Street, where architecture is, has got models of this sort at the moment, in a sense. And these are not digital by any means. There's bits of digitality in it. That's the whole point, that the idea of a pure digital twin is perhaps not really on the agenda. Any digital twin will be a mixture of both, really, in some sense. This is the London model, basically, and you can see that this is the Piper model that is used by the City Corporation to look at high buildings. You can make out some of those, and they're lit up. And there's a variety of low-level information technology used to actually do this, and you can see it's being used for public participation. And here's a picture of something we did a few years ago. This was simulating the Tottenham riots on what we call the London data table. And those are little Lego, those are police motorbike things, on Lego blocks, basically, in that sense. And you can see the inset, you can see a little boy actually playing with this data table. So it's a mixture of digital and non-digital, basically. And you can also see in that inset photograph there that that's our most famous person in CASA. That's Hannah Fry, who is a professor of mathematics of cities. And Hannah, of course, is a TV star. She really doesn't, she's only 2 hours a week or something in CASA these days, but on BBC TV telling us how mathematics works. Okay, so our four models. These are all bits. These are all centered on the Olympic Park in East London, basically. They're all centered on the building in the top left-hand corner, which is here east, which used to be the old media center back in 2012. It's been re-engineered. It's been retrofitted with sensors by the Connected Environments Group in CASA, basically. And then you can see that that's the building, basically. Then you can see Andy Hudson-Smith's 3D model that looks more like a kind of constructor set. It looks like a physical model. It's not physical in any sense. It's all done in Unity, basically. So you can see that all covers the Olympic Park area. That's John Reeds, who's our new head of department in CASA, back in 2012 or so, when we did a lot of flow analysis on the London Underground, basically, agent-based models in that sense. So those are our agent-based models in real time. And up to the left here, you can see some land use transport models, basically, and all of them relate to the same place. They all relate to the location of the Here East building. So in other words, the point is, you might say, well, these are all different models for different things, but if you are producing a local plan for what goes on at Here East, basically, you would need all of these perspectives, and indeed many more, basically. So this is giving you the idea that we can have more than one model, basically. Okay, now let me look at our long-term urban change model. We're scaling our models up everywhere because things are getting a lot faster. This is our classic land use transportation model. It just gives you an impression of what's going on here. This is a model that, given employment, we can predict where people live, and where people live, we can predict employment in that sense. We break into the simultaneity of the urban system in that particular way. And you can see the location in East London there. The little dots, basically, the little red dot on the left is the Here East building in that sense. This is a web-based model. It's a land use transportation model scaled up to the whole of, it's not the whole of the UK, it's England, Scotland and Wales. We've not got Northern Ireland in there for the simple reason that because the model is a gravitational transport related land use model, we've not been able to model movement across the Irish Sea in that sense, so it's restricted in that particular context. And you can see a variety of things. If you ask our architect, Richard Milton, about this model, he will tell you it's a model based on web services. I tend to think of it's a model based on you know, certain gravity model equations and so on. But in terms of the implementation of it, the really heavy lifting on the left-hand side, which is the client side, which is the server side, is really all to do with different types of web services. And then on the right-hand side, you can see what the user begins to see. So this is the way that model works. It's called Quant. This is a picture of what you would get if you run it. It's online. It's web-based. The reason why it's web-based is because we want planners in local authorities to use it to look at scenarios. I'll come to this in a moment. The other feature, of course, is it covers England, Scotland and Wales, because many of the big projects in Britain, and I'll show you an example of this with Crossrail in London in a moment, many of the big examples of these models really relate to these models relate to infrastructure projects which are spilling out of the edge of cities. If you look at Crossrail, which is a high-speed tube line running from East London to, well, it runs to Reading eventually now, and Heathrow and Reading. If you look at that line, basically, it has an impact over the whole of southern Britain. In fact, everywhere on the system, on the connected railway system, it has an impact in terms of time savings and so on. In that sense. So in other words, the reason why we're looking at England, Scotland and Wales is because of these big mega structure, these mega infrastructure projects, renewing the railways, particularly in Britain, but also really because we can now do it. We can scale up to look at these global effects. Computers are fast enough, basically. And we want it to be web-based because people can actually use it in that sense. Okay, so this is our population in that sense. That's the web link. If you type that in on your phone, the model would run. It's not brilliant on a phone, basically. It's sort of the graphics aren't really that good, but this is from a desktop in some sense. And this is very typical of what you can do. This is West Lancashire, this picture with Liverpool and the estuary and so on, and Manchester behind the on the right there, basically. And what we've done is to inject 40,000 jobs into Kirby Newtown, basically, into Knowsley, and look at the impact, basically. We've been doing this for 30, 40, 50 years, basically, in a sense. But now we're doing it on the web. We can do it quickly. The model, effectively, has 8,500 what we call MSOAs, census units. 8,500 census units. Generates 8,500 squared, which is 70 million potential trips. There's only 66 million people in Britain, basically. But it generates 70 million possible trips, basically. And the model has to work this for a variety of sectors, and it does it in about 30 seconds, basically. In fact, I was in a meeting the other day, and Richard, our architect, said he had it running in a second, basically. And he told me my time's up, basically. Don't worry, I'll round it out now. But basically, the model runs in a matter of seconds, basically. And it's improving all the time with these new chips, these new chips from the NVIDIA and so on that we seem to be piling into our systems, basically, then the thing can really run very fast indeed. And these are important. Now, this is Crossrail running across London. You can see the underground section. That's called the Elizabeth Line, basically. And this is really, I'm not going to explain, it's just the footprint of that line on the system. If you look at the top graph, you can see that lots and lots of places as far away as South Wales into Cornwall along the network are affected. The colour represents time savings. I'm not going to go into that, basically. Okay, now we're building a digital twin for London. Basically, what we've got is a model based on 8,500 zones for England, Scotland and Wales, we can move to the next level down. We can actually build the same model, but at the next level down. And if you look at the right and the left pictures here, one is the situation where in Britain we have something like 41,000 zones, and the other is the existing model with 8,500 zones. So in other words, it's a sea change. We're changing nothing in the model other than actually putting a different representation in. And in some senses, it's a clone of the model, but at a lower level of resolution. So it's a digital twin in that sense. And you can see this is the London bit, basically. All of that stuff on the left are the zones, basically, in that sense. And that scales up to something like 41,000 for Britain, 41,000 local census tracts, and it scales up to matrices of about 1.74 billion, basically. The model, as we ran it more recently, took about 8 minutes, not 30 seconds in that sense because of the geometric progression, but we are in the business of being able to do it, basically, in that sense. And that's one of the big kind of things. Now, one of the things that, I'm just going to go this through this very quickly, the last thing I'm going to say is that this picture actually shows you the one model versus the other model, the high-resolution model versus the low-resolution, and basically the two are very similar, scale to that level. Okay, we're adding in a walking layer, which has got lots of problems, basically. I'm running out of time here. And let me leave you with 3 points. I'll leave you to judge whether this is a useful way of thinking about the world. It is a way of thinking, really, rather than in that sense. The idea of federated digital twins, many twins and triplets, all of this is part of the argument. It forces us to think about what smart cities really are, which to some extent is what this meeting is focused upon. And it's really part of the wider debate about what cities are in that sense. You know, where do we define the boundaries? In the Smart City Index, for example, one of the major problems is how big is London? How big is Shanghai? How big is New York, basically, in that sense? I saw that London and New York were in the bottom half, but that's because, you know, you took the Wikipedia entry for London and it says 8 million. It's really 20 million, basically, probably, so to the southeast. Okay, so all of these things force us to think what a model really is all about, and that's probably useful. Thanks for listening, and there's some editorials in Environment Planning B. And I want to leave you on that picture, which is the Urban Informatics book, of which there is some bits and pieces in it of digital twins, and you can get it free and download it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Bhatti, for your expertise and sharing your insights with us today. Please have a seat. Thank you so much for sharing. And coming up next, we have Professor Guo Renzhong on stage, who will be introducing our second keynote speaker, Professor Goodchild. Professor Guo, please.
Yes, please, Professor Guo. You wear chairs.
Good morning. The next speaker is Professor Michael Goodchild from America. And this morning, a colleague of PolyU gave me a note for introducing Professor Michael Goodchild. It may be not useful, not necessary for me to introduce Professor Goodchild here because he's so famous. I think I don't know if there's anyone in this room who doesn't know Professor Goodchild. If you don't know Professor Goodchild, it will be difficult for you to be accepted as a member of the GIS community. So I think we should save time. Okay, let's applaud and welcome.
Thank you, Professor Gore and Professor Goodchild. The time is yours.
Thank you so much for that introduction. Thank you for the invitation to come. It's always very exciting to come to Hong Kong, particularly after the 4-year gap of the pandemic. And so I'm very pleased to be here. And this is going to be really something completely different. It's a very different perspective on digital twins. And in a sense, what I'm doing is setting up a classic exam question, which is compare and contrast. Compare and contrast these two presentations. I'd be very interested in hearing any thoughts you may have on that. I want to talk specifically from the perspective of urban planning, and I want to end with a research agenda, because one of my major concerns here is to encourage some of the research that we really need to make the dream of digital twins a reality. Because I hope you'll agree with me after I've finished that there are many things we don't know how to do. And it's very easy to imagine a digital twin, but to actually create a real digital twin in reality, I think, is something that is still in some ways beyond us. So some themes I want to explore. First, definitions. I want to go a little bit further than Mike did. Some of the earlier efforts. One of my objectives here is to tie the current concern with digital twins back into earlier efforts, specifically in GIS and in geodesign, both of which I think lead logically to digital twins. And I also want to make the point that I think of digital twins as essentially the culmination of everything that we think of in terms of urban informatics. So it is in many ways a very appropriate topic for these two opening talks. I want to talk about perfection. Mike has talked about that to some extent, and I want to talk about that in the context of ethics, because I think there's a serious ethical question here. I want to talk also about a tradition in planning which asks, can you have too much information? Can there be TMI? And if you think about it, building a digital twin might involve kilobytes, megabytes, gigabytes, possibly terabytes of information that, in a sense, are serving one purpose and one person purpose only, which is a decision, yes or no. And there's something of a paradox there in how much information we would put into a digital twin in order to satisfy a very simple purpose. And then I want to talk about the importance of dynamics and geodesign. And as I say, I want to finish with something approaching a research agenda and suggest to you some of the topics that you might take up as a doctoral candidate or as a junior researcher. You might take up to explore some of the missing pieces of the digital twin concept. There are many, many definitions. Mike has talked about these. I don't want to go through them in detail, but I do want to focus on one particular aspect. This is a very nice compilation put together by Danette Allen of NASA. And Mike has already mentioned, but I think it's worth emphasizing again, that the concept of digital twin is a generalization from manufacturing. Because in building an aircraft, the geometry of the aircraft can be captured to millimeters or better. The dynamics of the performance of an aircraft come from the laws of physics, such as, for example, the Navier-Stokes equation, which governs airflow over wings. And for both of those reasons, then, the results of working a digital twin, the results of a simulation of this model, are fit for certain purposes. And that, I think, is a very important motivation for what is now a very large industry using digital twins in the design and manufacture of aircraft. But if we generalize that now to environmental and social systems, something very fundamental happens. First, the geometry of an environmental or social system is at best meter level, possibly even worse than that. Much of the geometry in these systems is not replicable. The geometry, for example, in a map of soil type is not replicable. Two soil experts would not produce the same soil map. So, and further, the models that we need to simulate in the environmental or social world are scarce, and they're highly uncertain. The models that we learn a great deal about, such as, for example, the spatial interaction model, perhaps achieves 30% accuracy in its final analysis. So we're in a very different world, and that's why taking the idea of digital twins for manufacturing and moving it into environmental and social systems is so problematic. Mike talked about this concept that, I'll call it here perfection. And one of those definitions includes the following words: a set of virtual information, this is a digital twin, information constructs that fully describe an object or system from the microatomic level to the macro geometrical level. Something clearly we're nowhere near achieving in the environmental or social world. This definition, of course, is attributed to Greaves, who was working in the manufacturing context. but it does, in fact, define a Turing test. It says that you would not be able to distinguish between the predictions of a digital twin and reality, and therefore the predictions are fit for purpose. So that idea of a Turing test is something I want to come back to as we go through this. It's worth noticing, I think, that no twin can ever be perfect. Even what we call an identical twin. Two identical twins share DNA, but they don't share the nurture, the environment in which the two twins grew up. And so even identical twins are different. So that leads to an interesting question. If you build a digital twin for an environmental or social system, what is the equivalent of DNA? What are you getting right? And what are you getting wrong? And there are, I think, many possible answers to that question. So underlying all this is what I consider to be a very serious ethical problem. If you describe something as a digital twin, there may be an expectation on the part of the person listening to you that you have perfection, that your predictions are perfect. And reality, of course, is going to fall far short of that. That's led to the suggestion, and Mike mentioned a couple of these, but one that I think has been fairly successful, is to avoid calling something a digital twin and talk about instead a digital doppelganger, an interesting German term. Mike talked about a digital shadow. It's a similar kind of concept. So I want to think about why we are now so fascinated by digital twins, because there have been so many precursors. If we go back a little bit in history, back to the 1990s, to Gelertner's book, Mirror Worlds, in which he talks about a mirror city. It's essentially a digital twin. Or Al Gore, in his book, Earth in the Balance in 1992, who talked about digital Earth, a multi-resolution, three-dimensional representation of the planet into which we can embed vast quantities of georeference data. And Helen Kukletis, my colleague at Santa Barbara, talking about the construction of the digital city in 2004 and exploring many of the things that we're now raising in the context of digital twins. So as Mike suggested with his notion that a digital twin is simply a model, this is a very old idea. Ever since the origin of GIS, we have been building multidimensional representations and attempting, in essence, to build a digital twin. Here's where we are currently. This is an ESRI illustration, and it's from a document which argues that GIS forms the foundation for digital twins. And if we're talking about the environmental and social sciences, I think that's largely true. And I raise this because this picture, it's actually part of Philadelphia, does raise the question of the Turing test. Can you tell whether that picture was generated by a digital model or is actually a photograph? Because it is at a resolution which is well below the resolution of the human eye. So the human eye can't see any pixels. And it has been built possibly from a ground-based LiDAR scan of Philadelphia. And so it may well be the output of a digital model. So I'm going to make the point that this essentially passes the Turing test. You cannot tell. And that's specifically to this question of visualization. So in a very narrow sense, our digital twins are meeting the Turing test. But think about then this question of too much information. Is that a photograph or a computer-generated visualization? Yes, it passes the Turing test. There are some differences from reality, but you have to be there to know which they are. But the question then of whether there is too much information, and how much information does urban planning actually need? Is it important for visualizations to be photorealistic? Do we need then, this is the point I made earlier, do we need terabytes of information to make what is in the end a very simple planning decision? How much do we really need? And this, of course, is an old argument in urban planning. It's been around for a long time. It questions whether the artist visualization is actually, does it actually need to be realistic? Another important question here is why the term twin now? Might refer to the past 5 years. Why? What is it about the past 5 years? Has some kind of threshold been reached to explain current interest? And does it go beyond simple visualization? Certainly, computing data and models are increasingly abundant, but that process has been going on for half a century and is likely to continue, and moreover, it's likely to accelerate. And it doesn't matter how much more information we have or how rapidly it accelerates, we can never reach perfection. There can never be a perfect digital twin. So that raises then a different issue of ethics, I think. Is there a threshold level of perfection that allows someone to claim a digital twin? I think we have to agree that that's the level of perfection needed for a specific use. This is the fitness for use argument, that a given digital twin may be sufficient for certain specific uses, but not for others. Which raises a very tricky ethical question, which is how do we avoid repurposing? How do we avoid a digital twin being developed for one purpose and then turned to another purpose, which may be not particularly pleasant? There are many, many such examples of how a general purpose technology can be repurposed and misused. And then a very fundamental question, and again, Mike raised this in his talk, how do we measure imperfection? What are you measuring it against? There's no standard to measure against. So what do we mean by imperfection? If we were to go then beyond visualization, and I've argued that in the context of visualization, perhaps we satisfy the Turing test, what about dynamics? In urban planning, this means dynamic models of traffic, pedestrian movement, urban growth, land use. All of these are possible dynamic elements that we would expect to have in a digital twin. And that takes me back to an area that has been developing for the last, by now, 25 years, a quarter of a century, which is the area of geodesign. Because the area of geodesign argued that we had been building GIS for many purposes, but never for design. We were thinking about representing the world, we're thinking about how the world looks, but we weren't thinking much about intervening in the world. And so this effort in geodesign was intended to achieve that basic idea of intervention in the world. And this, of course, is planning. So what is geodesign? Carl Steinitz has argued that geodesign is changing geography by design, possibly using a digital twin. I've argued that GIS is about what is, about how the world looks. Geodesign is about how the world could be. And Jack Dangerman has argued that geodesign is designing with nature in mind. So a tradition of a quarter of a century built on the kinds of technology that we now have, BIM technology, for example, CityGML, the kinds of data that we now have on individual movement within cities. And to me, the great attraction of geodesign was always its ability to combine, on the one hand, creativity, sketch, intention, and on the other hand, evaluation, analysis, and prediction. So if you like to think of this as a bridge between the humanism, the aesthetics of the arts, and the science of evaluation and modeling, that's something that geodesign has always accepted as its basis. Translate that then to digital twins. And I think you'll agree with me that that aesthetic element is also important in digital twins, in the design of digital twins, in the interface to digital twins, and in the human in the loop, a point Mike made very convincingly. So what we have for geodesign, and I would argue for digital twins, is a great deal of understanding of spatial data models, a great deal of understanding of creative tools, tools that allow us to sketch design, a great deal of understanding of methods and modeling of methods. And so out of all this, I want to finish with what I think of as two distinct perspectives on digital twins. And the first is the conspicuous one, the one that is provided to us through these photorealistic 3D visualizations. Important for urban planning, even more important if models of dynamics can be included and predictions made possible. The question of whether the term twin gives a false impression, a misunderstanding of the inevitable uncertainty. And the probability, I think, that new scientific discoveries based on the existence of these digital twins is unlikely. These are not ways of discovering. These are more ways of seeing, visualizing, and presenting, communicating. So that's perspective number one. But I tend to think in terms of scientific research and scientific discovery, and that leads me to a very different perspective on digital twins. A more scientific perspective, a project to capture, preserve, and provide access to all of the data collected by scientists investigating many questions about a system. You have a given system, maybe a county or a city, and you have many people studying that system. And there is certainly an economy of scale in providing access through a single portal to all of that information. This would include the models, the data, and the conclusions that people have reached. And just to give you an illustration, here's one that I'm very familiar with. It does take me out of the urban planning context a little bit, but this is the Jack and Laura Dangerman Preserve on Point Conception in California. About 12,000 hectares of land devoted to conservation, open to researchers, and many hundreds of researchers every year visit, do their projects. And the idea is to collect all of that in the creation of a digital twin of the preserve. So here's a description from Dawn Wright. She's the chief scientist of ESRI, describing what she considers to be a digital twin of the Dangerman Preserve. A working model of natural and communities and ecosystems that is equipped with environmental sensors and artificial intelligence, and that can accelerate the process of understanding by modeling changes, testing how natural and human-engineered systems function, and enabling future scenario planning and management. Right? But a very different concept from the digital twin of the city. So not in itself a source of predictions. We're not thinking to predict the future of the preserve. No obvious relevance to the Turing test. You can't really ask the Turing test of such a system. But new discoveries will come from the research that is leveraged by the twin. Not from the twin itself, but from the stuff that's in the twin. So that seems to me to be a much more satisfactory perspective on digital twins for someone who thinks of the environmental and social sciences as research domains where discoveries need to be made. Now, I've mentioned a couple of ethical issues, but there are clearly more. Uncertainty is one, and I think there's ample evidence that the use of the digital twin term does tend to push uncertainty under the carpet. The potential for misinformation through deep fakes, false inferences, generative AI. the privacy of individuals, which becomes, of course, tremendously important in dealing with a digital twin of a city, the lack of transparency, because much of the software used in these systems is black box, and we may not know enough about the provenance of data. So there are ample ethical issues if your interest is in thinking about the ethics of digital twins. But from the perspective of research, I want to suggest a few research topics. And this model that I'm thinking about, my option number two, a repository in which you put all of this information, it suffers from our lack of ability right now to fuse data from different sources, to integrate data from different sources. Our lack right now of good models of process, and our problem in searching across a large number of data sets and process models. How do you search such a repository? And this is the kind of thing that a lot of people, of course, today are using AI methods to enable. Mike has talked a lot about the integration of digital twins. When you have more than one digital twin, how do you manage the differences between them? How do you manage across disciplines, across different scales, across geographic space? What happens when two digital twins overlap geographically? Many, many questions. And all of these, I would suggest, suitable research questions for anyone seeing their future as a research future in GI science. And then finally, education. Because if you were to structure a course in digital twins, how would you do it? What would be your key principles? Would there be a common set of software that you could use to demonstrate some of those principles? This is something I'd suggest entirely missing. I think right now we're going through a very exciting phase in education where all of our old education has been hugely disrupted by the introduction of new concepts such as AI and such as digital twins. So I hope I've convinced you that there are some many missing pieces here and much potential for serious research. So just to summarize with a few takeaway points. Number one, there's abundant and rapidly growing interest across industry and academia. As Mike said, digital twins are in many ways the flavor of the month. But there are many, many things that as soon as you delve into the details, become interesting research topics. I think the imperfect nature of all digital twins raises issues. I've suggested that using the term twin pushes those issues under the carpet, which I think is in many cases unethical. There are no standards for what can be claimed to be a digital twin. No one can say you are misusing the term because there are no standards. And if you're interested in delving more into some of the material I've been talking about, we held a workshop at Arizona State University in February, and the report from the workshop is online along with all of the presentations. And I'd encourage you to look there, at least as a first point of reference. So thank you very much for your attention. I hope that was interesting, and I look forward to further discussion.
Thank you very much, Professor Goodchild, for your perspectives and sharing with us your expertise. Please have a seat. Thank you very much. And in earlier keynote addresses, our two speakers have touched on digital twin technology, the digital representation of a physical object, person, or process contextualized in a digital version of its environment, and its applications in and implications on urban planning and smart city development. Now, what does the future of smart cities look like, and what are the challenges of our way forward? What are experts' views on this matter? Let's foster exchanges on ideas in the upcoming panel discussion. And may we now invite conference co-chairs, Professor Zhou Chenghu, Academician of the Chinese Academy of Sciences, and Professor Anthony Ye, Academician of the Chinese Academy of Sciences, Chair Professor of the Department of Urban Planning and Design of the University of Hong Kong on stage, please. and also our panelists, Professor Michael Batty, Fellow of the Royal Society, Professor Michael Goodchild, Member of the U.S. National Academy of Sciences, Professor Gong Jianya, Academician of the Chinese Academy of Sciences, Professor of Wuhan University, Professor Guo Renzhong, Academician of Chinese Academy of Engineering, Dean of Shenzhen University, Professor Jin Ying, Director of the Martin Center for Architectural and Urban Studies, University of Cambridge, as well as Professor John Shi, Director of Otto Poon Charitable Foundation Smart Cities Research Institute. A round of applause for all of our panelists, please. And a panel discussion will be on the topic, the future of smart cities. And when we're ready, may I pass the time to our co-chairs, Professor Zhou and Professor Ye, please.
Okay, thank you very much for the introductions from the MC. I think she's doing a great job. I would like to welcome the panelists. And I talked to Professor Zhao, and basically we have a division of labor. I'll try to ask the panelists to give us the idea about smart future smart cities, and then Professor Zhao will chair the sessions. And actually, Professor Zhao, I think he's very kind. He just arrived at Hong Kong last night, and today, after this panel discussion, he will go back to Beijing. Let's give him a round of applause for thanking him to come. Right. Now, maybe since we have roughly around, maybe 5 minutes each, right? Okay. And so we will talk about the future of smart cities. And smart city has been around since 2007, whatever we can say about, right? It's a long time already. And now we may have a smart city, I don't know, is it version 2, version 3, version 4, right? Maybe we'll see what the experts will be telling us. Maybe we'll go according to the list, maybe, on the schedule. Let's ask Professor Michael Batty to give us the view first.
Okay, well,
5 minutes, huh?
Okay. okay. Yeah, thanks, Tony. In some senses, if we talk about smart cities, we really need to think about cities. You know, what are cities in some sense? So there's a much bigger question there. Because smart cities, as they've been popularized, in places like Masdar and Songdo and all these sorts of places, you know, in the United Arab Emirates and Korea and so on, as they've been popularized, are very different animals, really, from most cities, in a sense. I mean, most cities actually grow from the bottom up. They're not planned from the top down. If you look at any big city, you can see elements of planning, but generally speaking, sort of most of the decisions made are made by individuals and smaller groups, perhaps even small groups actually acting collectively at a high level, but nevertheless built really from the bottom up in that sense. Most of the smart cities that have been developed for by companies and so on and by agencies are really top down, and they're almost a little bit like smart new towns in that particular context. And all of them, the ones that I've seen without exception, have really kind of hit the rocks basically very quickly. Masdar, for example, which is really a suburb of Abu Dhabi, I think, basically in the desert, is a town that is planned really to is planned basically for highly automated travel, highly automated just about everything. But of course, the participants who are attracted there, in a sense, are the nature of the town doesn't match their expectations in that sense, or the behavioural patterns. So I think that smart new towns we have to distinguish from, you know, smart cities. And so it's very difficult, I think, if you take this view that cities develop from the bottom up, to actually figure out whether our cities are smart in this particular context, in a way. Often people ask me, what is a smarter city? Is Tokyo a smarter city than London or something like that? Well, it's almost an impossible question to answer, in some senses. So it really relates, I think, to many of the ambiguities that relate to something like the Smart City Index, basically. That's a lot more, I think, what was John showed this morning, is a lot more related to, you know, how cities grow from the bottom up, because one's looking at existing cities, and none of those cities, I think, that were in the list basically are these sort of top-down smart new towns in that sense. So my point would be we have to be very careful about what we're looking for in terms of a collective noun, as it were, of a smart city per se.
Thank you, Professor Betty. Maybe I'll ask Professor Gong.
Thanks. I want to talk about the new problems. Is AIGC, artificial intelligent generated content. This is popular. We can use the photos and some LiDAR point code, build and structure the city model. But now the new technology, AI can generate content. The content may be the true, but also may be the false. How to know the the building, the city model, and even the picture and the video is true and the false. So I think this is a problem, also is a challenge for the smart city, how to know is true. I think we need to find some technology. Also, we need research for the law and some laws for the city build, city 3D model, city picture, city video, and some other contents. So this is my point. And also, is I think is smart city is a big change.
Thank you. Professor Gu Chao, please.
Thank you. I want to take this down to the level of the individual, because I think no smart city can really succeed without the support of the individual citizens. And that may require us to go down to perhaps not the individual, but maybe the neighborhood. There is, I think, here an issue of the appropriate level. And that's already been talked about in terms of the top-down versus bottom-up. But I think the essence of bottom-up is that it introduces the human and puts the human in the loop. Thinking back historically, I think that if you looked for examples of massive changes in individual behavior that result from technological developments, one of them would have to be the spreadsheet. Or we used to have, there was an earlier term for it, wasn't there? The very early applications, Lotus 1-2-3. What do we describe that as? I don't think spreadsheet was the term. And then, no, anyway.
Yeah, I think it was.
Was it?
Yeah,
okay.
VisiCalc,
yes. Because it changed individual behavior. It pushed people to purchase computers and to reorganize their lives. And so looking for similar things that might today change people's attitudes and get them to support the concept of smart cities enthusiastically, I think is a very critical search. I think that we have been in my neighborhood
very successful in the past few days. And I'm just talking about the 12 houses on the block in my city, but very successful at bringing people together because of an issue that we had to confront as a community. And this might also work for developing the smart city and bringing the human into the loop. That's one perspective that I think is very important. I think that we will also have to consider the possibility that at some point in the future, and I'm talking here specifically about the English language, but we may have to consider the possibility that the phrase smart city has a limited life. We have been through this not so long ago with big data. I think most people would agree that the enthusiasms that big data generated perhaps 15 years ago are no longer as evident. We will have to think about the same question with smart cities. One thing that I'm always tremendously impressed with is the survival of GIS as a term. Because although there have always been many competitors, we still are united in many ways around the acronym GIS. Maybe its success was in part because it's an acronym. It doesn't carry any baggage. So maybe an acronym based on smart cities will have a longer lifetime than the fully decoded version of smart city.
Oh, thank you. Maybe Professor Guo.
Okay, thank you. Okay. I think it's really a good topic for discussion here, the future of smart cities. But this topic is also, I think, disputable because it implies that when we are talking about the future of smart cities, we should know or we must know what's the state of the art of smart cities. Which cities, is there any cities in the world which can be called smart? Of course, every city is smart, just like other people. Everyone is smart. But I think perhaps they are not so smart as we hope, as we expect. So just as this morning to Professor Michael and Professor Bailey and Professor Kuchada, they talked on digital twin cities. Just now, Professor Gong talked also on city modeling. But for example, even now, after working several years, we don't know exactly what we need specifically for a digital twin. If we want to build a model with a really high resolution, just as said, photorealistic or quite generalized abstract. So we don't know. So we use some detail degree of class, for example, from layer 1 to layer 17, something like this. So I think it's very difficult to know the future of smart cities, what the smart city will be like, how it will operate. It's just that we should work on. It's not something we talk here. It's something we should work on it. So in my opinion, there are two directions which may be clear in the near future. For example, for building a digital twin city, namely for building a city model. As there are so many projects, practical projects, proceed carried out, for example, in China, in many cities in China. I think after several years, we are arrived at a stage where we know what we need for digital twin, what we should do, and what there can be helpful, useful for governing, for planning our cities. And another problem is that when we are talking about building a smart city, we must know we must study the modern cities. Cities are always called cities, but the modern cities, they do not operate, they do not function as the olden cities. Because the social life, the industry changed a lot. So for building smart cities, I think we must research, we must study what's the characteristics, how it works, the modern cities. This is what I'm thinking of now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Gao. Professor Jin, please.
Thank you, Tony. If I could briefly emphasize one point, which is more a social point of smart cities, which is about the younger generations in cities. For me, smart cities are really about where the young generations are well supported, because they're the future of the cities. And the panel here, obviously you'll agree with me, because the panel here actually are great educators and scientists and the leaders in the fields, and then they have already done a great deal in supporting young people. But in the wider society, there are two changes which are noticeable, and also we need to be factoring this into the planning of cities. Number one, there are fewer young people coming up, and almost in every country, maybe in Africa, in India, this hasn't been a great worry, but even the Indian population is not growing as fast, because the birth rate is below the replacement rate at this moment. Now, the other one is that the younger generation, relative to the older generations, are less supported in cities. High living cost, less accessibility to housing, right? And also lack of the diversity of the career opportunities. And these are great challenges. Maybe this audience actually will resonate with these. But if you think you're facing challenges, you are still the most privileged among society. There are actually fellow citizens of the same age who are facing great challenges, much greater challenges. And for me, if we focus more on this, we're likely to provide more momentum to the development of smart cities. This is because young people are very good with tech. They're very supportive of new smart tech developments. And if they are motivated, smart tech will generally follow, both in its development and also in its application. But also, young people are at a stage where they can also vote with their feet. So every city and every mayor need to be really careful that to retain this most valuable resource. Thank you.
Oh, thank you very much, Professor Jin, and maybe Professor Xi.
Testing, yeah. Thank you, Chair. I would like to share my view as number one, why we develop smart city, says aiming. Perhaps one of the objectives is to, you know, have a better life for everybody. So my view is, you know, smart city for everyone. So that's the view. Number two is what's the current urban problems or city problems that we need to solve and to make our cities better, and so people have a better life. So I think, you know, the traffic congestions, pollutions, public health, and urban disasters, you name this. So I think either we go through technology solutions or other policy issues, and then we solve those problems and make our life better. Then I think Professor Ying mentions about the younger generation. Let me also share with you the aging issues, say for example in Hong Kong. So I think our cities, or smart cities, you know, she will make everybody have a better life. So we should look after the young generation. So for example, housing issues in many larger cities need to be considered. And aging issues, for example, Hong Kong is one of the aging cities. Then we need to have both technology solutions and also, I think, policy issues to support that, so make everybody have a better life. The third one I want to share is what kind of a technology may impact our future smart city development. I think that we mentioned about AI, then in our field we call it dual AI, and this is sensing technologies, the city sensing, then we do the urban sensing part, have image technologies, and also social sensings, then with AI technology to support, then we have a better understanding and a better prediction. And second, yes, both Professor Gucha and Betty and mentioned about a digital team, then I think that's another very important part. So technology behind us to support the digital twin, this is urban 3D city modeling. These are based on satellite image, based on air photos, based on LiDAR, or ground laser scanning technology to capture data and to have the digital twin in different resolution or scale. As I mentioned, we need that for different application purpose. And also we need to have, I think, a link with AI, with this digital twin, and a simulation technology to really solve problems based on digital twin. And then I think future urban computation, and say for example, we use this technology so for a prediction model with urban mobility data and confirmed cases of COVID for a prediction of COVID, then help people really in less difficult situations. So I think that sort of technologies, that's AI, digital twin, and I think future autonomous driving may change the behavior of mobility in the future, both vehicles and the humans one. So that's where the point I would like to share. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. I think the panelists has already gave off a very good address about the how the smart city will go about, particularly in terms of technological development, AI, and digital twins, and also other issues, and more importantly, the type of people that we are going to serve, the young and also the old, which are basically how we are able to do it. And one thing that maybe we have to also realize, just like what Professor Goodchild saying, GIS has been here, right? Why people want to spend money in GIS, there must be a purpose. And they would like stating that money can help us, this reason why we want to invest in it. Just like smart cities, the government has invested a lot of money, and also the private sector have invested a lot of money. But as a product, there must be some utility. If we do not find a utility there, why should we spend money? Right? So basically, I think in the future, I think the smart cities have to demonstrate that that is basically, it is helping us. And then I think just like GIS, right? Actually, it has already demonstrated. We are now living in a smart society because of smart cities technology. And basically, I think the future will be even, it will be part of the city DNA already, smart cities, right? And so how can we make it better? Maybe I'll turn it over to Professor Zhao.
Okay, thank you. I would like to say really thanks to our six distinguished panelists to give us some the idea about the future of the smart city, from small town to mega city, from individuals to whole society, from the geometrical world to human-based world, from the information to the cyber-spectral cities, especially for the future smart city for the younger generation. Maybe we never know what is a smart city, just mentioned by Gottschild and Professor Betty Gottschild said, the digital twin is imperfected. Maybe we can say the smart city never be perfected. If we never reach the perfect smart city, what do we want for the future cities? Maybe we don't put too much money for the smart infrastructure. Maybe we need a more smart society, smart economics, smart people, citizens.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, thank you. Maybe are there any other opinions that our panelists would like to raise before I open it to the floor? I think we should have some feedback or maybe participations together, since I think we still have around 10 minutes time, right? Anything that you want to add? If not, then let's open to the floor, right? The floor is yours. Maybe you can just shout whatever and tell us what you think will be the future of smart cities, or what you think. Right? Oh, okay. So, Rosanna, okay. Maybe you can tell us your name and then your affiliation before, so that we can know you, right? Yeah.
Thank you, Professor Ye. First of all, I'd very much like to thank all the speakers this morning. It's absolutely fantastic. I've learned so much from all the masters, really, and very informative as well, and not to mention very inspiring. But I think, I guess, my question would be very simple to all the panelists, but more towards, if we don't use the word smart city, what word shall we use? And if the tween is not quite correct, in a sense, which I totally agree, what word can we replace tween? And seems to me, by listening to all the speaker, do we need to find some sort of a baseline or standard globally in order to tackle the challenges a lot of the speakers has mentioned before? My name is Rosanna Wong. Today I represent, I should say, Smart City Consortium. I'm the VP and I'm also the Chair of Smart Living. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Rosanna. Any more questions before we ask our panelists to respond? Okay, I think there is a question for all you guys, right? Who would like to respond? These are very big questions, right?
Honestly, I don't think there is a better word. I think that we have to accept what philosophers have been telling us for a long time, that words frame discussion. And perhaps a collection of words would be better than one word. Right now, I think that, well, I made the point that GIS succeeded because it was an acronym, not a word. And so it was up to you as to how you interpreted it. Many people, I think today, think GIS stands for Geologic Information System or Global Information System. And what that does is broaden the tent. It allows geologists and global scientists to be part of the GIS field. If we could do something similar, I think, with Smart City, we might have the same impact. If we could think of an acronym, ABC. And ABC, what it stands for depends on you. Because otherwise, we frame the discussion with our choice of words. And SMART carries an enormous baggage. If we start talking about society evolving into one that is split between the overeducated and the undereducated, SMART comes in there. It will fuel that debate. It is fire to particular areas. So, yeah, I think for now we're stuck with SMART, that's fine. But let's not be too concerned if at some point in the future we realize there's a better word. I'm also very concerned about the dominance of English in anything having to do with tech, and how I was asking, in fact, you this morning, what the equivalent, what SMART translated to in Cantonese, and what it suggested, what baggage it carried. And I would love to know, and I wonder if this is an activity that John's center might take on, to look across the world at all of our 6,000 languages, at what words are used to translate SMART. We might learn quite a lot from that.
I think there's an even further play on the word SMART in English. I mean, there's no question in my mind that the Americans use SMART differently from the way the English use SMART. Basically, my mum used to say, don't get smart with me, you know, sort of thing. And that's exactly it. I went to a TED conference about 10 years ago, which was on smart cities, and quite a few of the presentations were mainly English people, basically, it was in England, felt that the word smart was not being used in the literature and the context. Smart was being used quite differently from the American sense to what we were using it in English, basically. So I think there are these differences. So I support what Mike says about the language. And it wouldn't surprise me if the word smart were used differently within different disciplinary perspectives in the UK in that sense, or in the United States in that particular context. Because I believe, I mean, you probably know Mike better than I do, but the term smart growth was introduced long before the idea of smart cities. And my understanding of smart growth was that it was a contrast with, it was a managed kind of sprawl, basically. Smart growth was not urban sprawl in the traditional American sense, but it was managed growth in that sense. And it was smart, it was intelligent in that particular way. And that's probably quite a useful way of using the word smart, basically. But once it gets into this more generic context, it's very problematic, I agree.
Okay. John?
Mike just mentioned about Chinese translation. I think with the English one, smart, I think we will have a different part of meaning. But Chinese translation in Cantonese is ziwai. In Mandarin is zhihui. So in Chinese part, it's no problem with that translation, both positively. So in terms of English one, what's the word better? I think in the six wings of smart cities, except smart people, and I think other five is okay. So in general, I think we keep smart cities. I think this should be fine, at least at this stage. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, I think it's about time for us to have lunch. It's a long day. Before I end, I would just like to some sort of observation. It's basically in the 1930s, there is a very famous work called Urbanism as a Way of Life. Because that time is really changing, you know, how people from rural society to urban society, right? And now I think we should talk about smart cities as a new way of life. I think we are now in the smart city era. With that, I think let's thank all the panelists for their nice discussion.
Thank you all panelists and also our co-chairs for this thought-provoking discussion, and I hope you all have some takeaways. And ladies and gentlemen, once again, let's give a round of applause to our co-chairs and panelists. Thank you all, and please have a seat. Yes. And this, at the end of this panel discussion, also signifies the conclusion of the opening ceremony, and live streaming will now come to an end. And as mentioned, it's almost lunchtime, but before we leave the auditorium, here's a warm reminder that there will be parallel sessions and technology information exhibition this afternoon, so do check them out. And the parallel sessions include both invited and theme-based sessions covering a range of topics. Further details are available on the conference website, and you're welcome to stay on PolyU campus for lunch at VA Student Canteen, and there are also good restaurants nearby you may want to check out. And let's grab the opportunity to exchange thoughts and views with our fellow conference participants from a diverse array of backgrounds. And for speakers and guests, please follow our conference staff to the invited lunch. And the afternoon session will start at 2:30 p.m. Please enjoy your lunch break and see you soon. Thank you.